And this is just to apply what we've just learned. And so the question reads as follows. In 1996, the Special Investigating Unit, SIU, was established in terms of the Special Investigating Units and Special Tribunal Act 74 of 1996. The SIU's principal mandate is to investigate, in inverted commas, serious malpractices or maladministration in connection with the administration of state institutions, state assets, and public money, as well as any conduct which may seriously harm the interests of the public. Then the question is, which of the following is incorrect? Option A is PUJA and its rigorous review standards ought not to apply to any conduct of the SIU so as to ensure efficiency in its investigations. The second option is it may be desirous to exclude the application of PUJA and its rigorous standards to some but not all conduct of the SIU. An inquiry into the nature of the conduct must in each case be carried out. Next, option C is if PUJA does not explicitly exclude the conduct of the SIU from its ambit, PUJA ought to apply. And then D is A, B, and C, and E is only B and C. So we have to work out which of those options at least is correct. Now, the first option, PUJA and its rigorous review standards ought not to apply to any conduct of the SIU, is incorrect. That's because of, in part at least, the SAFU principle that says you have to work out whether or not PUJA is applicable or whether or not conduct is administrative action by looking at the function performed by the relevant organ of state, in this case the SIU, and not the functionary. So we look at what the SIU is doing as opposed to the mere fact that we're engaged with a particular body, the SIU. So we have to, in each case, before we decide whether or not PUJA should appropriately apply to conduct, examine exactly what conduct is being performed and whether it's appropriate for particular kinds of conduct to be subject to PUJA's standards or not. And so question A is asking you, or option A is giving you an all or nothing scenario. It's saying PUJA and its rigorous standards ought not to apply to any conduct of the SIU. That's an all or nothing scenario. And what we've just learned is that it might be appropriate for some conduct to be subject to PUJA, but not other conduct, and that in each case you have to engage with the substantive reasons why conduct should or should not be subject to PUJA's standards when we work out whether or not the conduct is or is not administrative action. The second option is that it may be desirous to exclude the application of PUJA and its rigorous standards to some but not all conduct of the SIU. An inquiry into the nature of the conduct must, in each case, be carried out. Now, this option hopefully seems correct to you. It seems like adopting a substantive approach or encouraging a substantive approach to working out whether or not PUJA should regulate certain conduct of the SIU. And the substantive approach would involve looking at whether, in the particular case of the particular conduct, it's appropriate in the sense of desirable, possible, and necessary for PUJA to regulate the particular conduct. And so B is potentially the correct answer, but we must keep checking because there are possibilities of B and C being correct. So we keep looking down and we ask ourselves, is C also correct? And with C, it says, if PUDGA does not explicitly exclude the conduct of the SIU from its ambit, PUDGA ought to apply. Now, there's two important things to note about this option. The first is, we're asking here the ought question. So we look at this word here, ought. We're asking whether PUDGA ought to apply, not whether it does apply. That's the first thing. So we're asking, in other words, is whether it's appropriate for PUDGA to regulate conduct purely because PUDGA doesn't exclude conduct from its ambit. And the second thing to note about the statement is we're aware that there are a list of specific exclusions. And one way to understand the definition of PUDGA, if we were adopting a formalistic approach, were to say, well, if something's excluded, it means it's not administrative action. If public power is excluded, it's not administrative action. So all other conduct must fall within the definition of administrative action. But the courts have said to us that's not the correct way to interpret Section 1 of PUDGA, that we must in each case make a positive finding about whether or not conduct is or is not administrative action, falling within all of the elements of the definition. And only thereafter do we consider, is the conduct excluded? So we don't start with the exclusions, and we don't mechanically look at the conduct and the definition. We inquire from a substantive perspective whether or not the conduct is of such a nature that PUDGA should apply. Now, option C is essentially asking us to adopt a formalistic approach to interpreting PUDGA, and we know we're not supposed to adopt a formalistic approach, so therefore we can rule out option C as the correct answer for all of the reasons I've just discussed. And that then means, of course, that option D and option E cannot be correct. And so option B is the correct answer in this situation. There's just two more things that we need to discuss on this particular topic, and or two more slides at least. And those slides relate to something called a theory of variability. Now, what Hoekstra says to us, and I'll read this from her book at page 151, is that the idea of judicial deference is tied to the idea of variability. Now, you'll remember that, hopefully anyway, that when we talk about what is appropriate for the courts to scrutinize with reference to the standards of administrative law, we are talking about separation of powers considerations, and we are talking about the courts showing an appropriate degree of respect to the power exercised by the other two branches of government. And so we're talking essentially about a theory of deference. And deference is discussed at 151 of Hoekstra's book, where she says it consists of a judicial willingness to appreciate the constitutionally ordained province of administrative agencies, to acknowledge the expertise of those agencies, to give their interpretations of fact and law due respect, to be sensitive to the interests legitimately pursued by administrative bodies, and the practical and financial constraints under which they have to operate. So it's about giving effect to the separation of powers and showing appropriate respect to the other branches of government. And so this is something that we must consider when we talk about what should and should not be subject to review by the courts in terms of PUDGA. And what PUDGA says, or at least what Hookster says, sorry, is that deference and adopting appropriate respect towards the other branches of government is tied to the notion of variability. She says this is the simple idea that the grounds of review need not be applied in an all-or-nothing fashion, and that the intensity of judicial review may vary according to the context. So she goes on to explain, as a matter of logic, all the grounds of review, lawfulness, fairness, and reasonableness, as well as the duty to give reasons, apply to all conduct that is defined as administrative action, at least in the context of PUDGA. So if an action qualifies as administrative, it will potentially be subject to every one of the grounds listed in Section 6 of PUDGA. However, there is room for variation in the manner in which these grounds are applied and in the strictness with which they are enforced. And this is particularly evident in the areas of procedural fairness, reasonableness, and the giving of reasons. Variability in what constitutes fairness, she says, has been the orthodoxy or the norm for decades. And our courts have also recognized more recently that reasonableness can be context dependent, and that the adequacy of reasons will vary from case to case. So what is all of this about? Well, what Hookster is getting at here is to explain that there are two ways that we could limit the scope of application of PUDGA. The first way is to say what amounts to administrative action is only this little thing here. So PUDGA only applies to this narrow kind of conduct. And so that's looking at what does and does not fall within the definition of administrative action. The second way to limit the scope of application of PUDGA is to say, well, let's include lots of things within the definition of administrative action, but then we acknowledge that the standards of administrative law, fairness, reasonableness, lawfulness, are onerous and demanding on administrators. So we can manage the burden that is imposed by including conduct within the realm of PUDGA by applying those standards in a lighter way, like this, where it's appropriate to do so, and applying them in a more demanding way, like here, where it's appropriate to do so. So a good example of this would be to say, let's say that a decision to evict people from a building when it is in a hazardous condition, when the building is in a hazardous condition, is administrative action. So we've tested that conduct against all the requirements of the definition, and we found that the conduct does fall within the definition of administrative action. So now that decision to evict must be procedurally fair, and it must be reasonable. But remember that for conduct to be procedurally fair, it must be it must follow a fair process before the decision is taken. So you must consult and you must give people notice, etc. But here we've got a hazardous building, so we probably want to apply procedural fairness light and give a very brief time of notice, very brief opportunity to consult, and not require that there be a long and detailed process, because to do so would demand a long period of time, would inhibit efficiency, and would potentially put people at risk. So here, deference and respect to the other branches of government means not excluding the decision from administrative action, from the definition of administrative action, and therefore from Pudge's standards, but including the conduct within Pudge's realm and applying procedural fairness in a light way so as to show respect. And this is what Hoekstra refers to as applying a theory of variability, and courts are empowered to do this by virtue of the separation of powers doctrine. So let's look at a question where we try and understand that concept. This multiple choice question says, the notion of variability, A, recognizes that administrative law's grounds of review need not be applied in an all or nothing fashion. B, entails that the intensity of judicial scrutiny when testing conduct against the administrative law's grounds of review may vary according to the context of a particular case. C, is tied to judicial deference in that it supports the judiciary showing respect to the other branches of government when appropriate. D, promotes context-sensitive reasoning rather than rule-based formalistic reasoning. Or E, all of the above. Now, hopefully, based on the discussion that I've just had with you about variability, and if you read page 151 of Hoekstra, you will see that the correct answer is E, all of the above. And you should go back and look at the textbook and listen to what I've just explained about variability to see if you can work out why the answer is E, all of the above. Very important in studying and preparing for this course is to really try and understand concepts and how they apply. And the best way to do that is to go and read cases and to ask yourself, how does this idea of variability apply in this case? Or how could it apply? And understanding that administrative law standards need not apply in an all or nothing fashion is a really important thing. But it goes back to administrative law being a tricky area of law, because as Hugh Corder says in the first chapter of Quino's book, it means that the administrative law is grey, like my jersey, rather than being a black and white matter.